Amen. We're having a good time in the Lord. I don't care what they say. How many of y'all believe Jesus is coming soon? I believe Jesus is coming soon. In 1 Peter chapter 1, I want you to notice where we're going. One of the things I want to bring this book out to you, because Peter had a dynamic change in revelation, steadily growing, and helps people to grow even today and sets them free from the laws of sin and death. And I believe when you get the idea of the laws and sin and death, of sin and death sending people to hell, that you can pretty much assume that you need to know about the laws of God. But you know what? They're after the inward man. And some people has a corrupt inner man. They've never been born again. And our churches are full of people today that's never been born again. And I find it so sad that we're living in those days. They don't talk about being born again. They don't talk about repentance. They don't talk about receiving Jesus as your Savior. Most of the time, they only talk about money, and they only talk about things that, you know, do not edify, just like their crazy books. You know, they kept lifting Rick Warren's book up for the past 10, 15 years. It goes back farther than that. Back into the 90s, it's been at least 20 years, maybe more, close to it, of his book that says we should go out to the world and find out what kind of church they want and make our church after them. And we should see what kind of music they want and make our church after them. And they claim that he sold 25 million copies. And you know, I admit, they had a con game out here at Christ Life Sanctuary. I remember when that lady was on the radio teaching Rick Warren's book. Is that stupid or what? Nobody said anything to her about it. I think there's some idiots that probably listened to her. But the book didn't have anything to do with God. I had some other Christians to tell me, oh, I really got blessed on that book. Seriously, what did it say about Jesus and the Holy Ghost and repentance and serving God, casting out a devil, healing the sick, or anything? It didn't say anything. 40 Days of Purpose. Y'all remember the book? That's a pattern of the books that they're doing today with Joyce Meyer, T.D. Jakes, Osteen, Creflo Dollar, and all these people. They're the same kind of books written by the same people. You know, so that's what we're facing today. And they take this kind of stuff, lift it up on the news media, and they have formed the generation that they want. Now, saying that, to say this, I want to take you into our scriptures. I want you to look at me with 1 Peter chapter 1. I want you to notice verse number 2. And I want to take you into this quickly. And I want to go to verse 13 afterwards. And I want to show you some things that I think are very, very important. Verse number 2, Peter says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience, the sprinkling of blood of Jesus Christ. He said, grace be unto you and peace be multiplied. If you notice, this verse number 2 takes you directly into the covenant of God that they showed you through Exodus chapter 24, whenever they entered into a covenant. Moses had taken the laws of God from Mount Sinai, written them down, and in chapter 24, with verse 6 or 7, actually it's a little bit before that. I'll read it to you. It says here, verse number 2, Exodus 24, Moses alone come near the Lord, and they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up. So the whole idea is in verse 3 of Exodus 24, Moses came and told the people all the words. Now listen to this very carefully. Verse number 3. Told them all the words of the Lord, all the judgments, and all of the people answered with one accord and said, all the words which the Lord has said we will do. And Moses wrote all the words and rose up early in the morning and builded an altar in the hill and the 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he took the blood in verse 5 and 6 and he sprinkled it on the altar. He took the book in verse 7, the book of the covenant, read it audibly to the audience of the people, and they said, all that the Lord has said, we will do. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it upon the people and said, Behold the blood of the covenant, which the Lord hath made with you concerning this. And then they says in verse 9 and 10, they began to fellowship with the Lord. That's the same thing that happened on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. Whenever God was able to write His laws into the hearts of the people. So here this is Peter, this is who Peter is writing to. But many are called and few are chosen. I want you to notice where we're going with this word elect and foreknowledge. Many people are called and few are chosen. And we want to talk about the foreknowledge of God just a little bit so people can understand this. You know, the foreknowledge of God, I talked about it in the little paper that I handed out. If you notice, it says to thoroughly define this word. 4268 in Strong's, in the Greek section, for the word foreknowledge talks about prognosis. How many of y'all been a doctor where he would go over your blood work, or go over your blood pressure, something like that? That's about what they do today. And they give you a prognosis. Well, you've got this problem. Well, you've got that problem. And you know where that comes from? That comes from the word prognosticate, which is to tell you something in the future. Where do you find that word at? You find prognosticate in Genesis chapter 3 when Adam and Eve ate of the fruit. You want me to read this to you from Genesis 3? Tell you where it comes from. This is very important stuff. If you love your Bible, I'm sure you'll like this. It's said in these words, such as verse 5, that you shall be of gods, knowing good from evil. You look at these kind of words and it talks about known, new, K-N-E-W. And it talks about knowing this. And the whole idea of this, like in verse 7, it uses the word they knew. It says he knew his wife and this is what happened. Now if you look up these words in Genesis chapter 3, you find the word prognosticate. We preached about that years ago, but I didn't really know exactly where it went. But the ideal is it was to tell them their future. And I want to talk to you today how about you can be a better witness, how you can tell people about your future. And it's a lot better than a soothsayer, amen? It's a lot better than a gypsy fortune teller. I want to talk to you today about your end results, and I want to tell you how to be a good Christian. And how to help people that you can tell them about the end of their life. Through the foreknowledge of God, some will tell you that God knows everything. I believe He does. But I believe God has laid down the Scriptures to give you a pattern as to how you can help people and how you yourself can know a whole lot more than what you know today. If you notice something, I said this word foreknowledge goes to prognosis and it shows God's ability to warn or enlighten people is what I have written down as to the outcome of their life. This is generally done with Scripture. Now notice this, or with a messenger such as a prophet or in some cases maybe an angel. As an example would show God's ability to predict with Scripture the future of those who walk in the Spirit and abide in Him. Now, are you following me here? In other words, the Bible teaches what we call predestination in Romans chapter 8. You know what that means? God has a destination picked out for you. But the whole idea of this rests upon whether or not you will walk in the Spirit, whether or not you will stay in the Scriptures, and whether or not you will obey God. If you do, your future is picked out and it's destined. The Bible talks about it in Romans chapter 8. That whom He foreknew, He did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son. If you stay in the Spirit and you let God do a work on you, the Bible is clear. Jesus said that He would cleanse you, that He would set you free. To give you an example of what I mean, in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, being confident of this very thing, that God will who hath begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. And that means that if you stay with God, He's going to clean you up. You may not be what God wants you to be right now, but you stay with Him, obey Him, stay in the Scriptures, walk in the Spirit, and God will make you to be what He wants you to be. And that is going to depend totally upon you. But you remember, if you stay with Him, you're predestined to get into heaven. You're predestined to have eternal life. You're predestinated to be a king. You're predestinated to be a wealthy person. You're predestinated to be famous. You're predestinated to have eternal life. You're predestinated, according to Revelations 1, 5, and 6, to have a throne. According to Revelations 24, to sit up on a throne, and judgment will be given to you. You're predestinated to know God in His great glory, and nobody shall see God except He's pure in heart. But God has said He would do it. If you believe the Scripture, say amen. Amen. On the other hand, you look at people today, it also tells you their destination. I'm sure you got friends that don't go to church. I'm sure you know people that claim to be a Christian, but they have no fruits. I'm sure you know people that, oh yes, I'm saved. Yeah, well, you know, let's see some fruits, because Jesus said, by their fruits you shall know them. Can I hear an amen? I mean, this is a Bible quotation, and you have to go along with the Scriptures. I believe every word in the Bible is anointed of Jesus. That's His holy word. Amen? Amen. So we're living in a time now when a lot of people say a lot of stuff, but you find out that their destination and the eternity will tell you out, will tell you about them. If people want to know about their future, all you got to do is go to the Bible. Of course, we know that John 14, 17 says that Jesus is truth. But you remember in John chapter 8, Jesus said, I told you the truth and you want to kill me. A lot of people hate the truth. Can I say amen? Amen. They don't want to hear the truth. They want you to tell them a lie. They want you to tell them a Joe Osteen story. They want you to tell them about Rick Warren, about Creflo Dollar, who said that Jesus is not God. They love that, and they pack His church out every Sunday to give Him hundreds of thousands of dollars. They like those stories. There's something about the devil and flesh and lust that go together. Can I hear an amen? Amen. But when you tell them the truth, you'll get your crowd to kind of dwindle down. Something about people, they just don't like the truth. I wonder why. Amen? I mean, that's kind of the way it is. Now I want to take you to the next level of this story, or this message, or whatever. I want you to go with me to verse 13 in your Bible. 1 Peter 1:13, I want you to notice what it says. Wherefore, for this reason, gird up the loins of your mind and be sober. Hope to the end for the grace that it be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Everyone should take heed and listen to this very carefully. I've preached to you for a couple of years now and talked to you continuously about your mind. I want to show you how the Bible is able to give you a foreknowledge of what's going to happen to people that don't know the mind. You can look at people right now that go to church. Oh, to hear them tell it, they give their money and they're saved. You know, there's a little problem with that. How many of y'all know that God doesn't need your money? No, you need to give to God, because you have to be proven that you don't trust in money. Because many people trust in money. Many of them listen to Joel Osteen and all of his lies. And all those other preachers. Creflo Dollar and Eddie Long, Duplantis, Copeland. They're all a bunch of Illuminati liars. And you know, people need to tell on them. But anyway, I won't go there. Verse 13, let's talk about gird up the loins of your mind. In many places in the Bible, it talks about your mind, using scriptures like Ephesians 4, 23 and 24. Says if you want to renew your mind by the Spirit, then you can begin to put on the new man. The ideal is that nobody is going to reach spiritual maturity, means morally and mentally delivered, unless they learn the ideal of the mind. People don't know how vulnerable your minds are. They don't want to talk about that in the church world. Romans 12, 2 and 3, it talks about transformed by the renewing of your mind. Can I hear an amen? You talk about people that don't They don't have any idea of the mind. I mean, it just is not where they're at today. In Philippians chapter 3, Paul said that, "Let this mind be in you which was in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery," that's chapter 2 verse 5, "thought it not robbery to be equal with God." He told you what to do with your mind. But in chapter 3, you find out that he had paid a great price according to the world. You know what he did? He gave up everything. And he took time to put his mind like Jesus. And you know what? I learned a whole lot from that. Me and Mark was talking about it. Each of us would like to go according to Galatians chapter 1. Paul spent 3 years in Arabia. You know why he did that? Can I show you? Okay, thank you. In Galatians chapter 1. Look, I'll show you. It's very simple. Galatians chapter 1, Paul says in verse number 8, he said, "Though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel than this unto you, let it be accursed." He said, "As we said before, I say to you again, if any man preach any other gospel, let him be accursed than this which you've received of me." How did Paul get this great knowledge? Notice what he said in verse 10. "For do I now persuade men, or is it God? Or do I seek to please men? If I please men, I should not be the servant of God." You can't please both. So what he says in verse 11, "I certify to you, brother, that the gospel which I preached unto you is not after men. For I neither received it of men, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ." The ideal is, how did he get a revelation from Jesus Christ? He goes on to say, "Ye have heard of my conversation in the times past, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church." He goes on to say, "And profited in the Jewish religion above many of my equals. Nevertheless," verse 15, "but when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal unto me his son, that I thought myself to preach him among the heathen immediately." Now look what he did in verse 16. This is where it goes. He said, "Immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood, neither I went up to Jerusalem to see them that were apostles before me." But what did he do? He said, "I went to Arabia and returned not again to Damascus." In verse 18, "After 3 years of seeking God, he went up." My whole point here is to say in this right here, you can do a lot of things with your mind. You can give your mind over to the world. You can go ahead and believe you're a Christian. But the revelation that I told you in verse 2 from 1 Peter 1 tells you that there is a system laid down in the Bible that tells you the end results of people who do not have their mind taken care of. You know what Paul said in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17, he says this, that the law of the minds, and this is kind of what he said, "the mind of man is vanity against God." Should I read it to you? In chapter 4, if you notice verse 17, "This I say therefore, brethren, testify in the Lord, that you walk as none other Gentiles walk in the vanity of your mind." And the word "testify" talks about that he's going to be a witness against people that has a bad mind. I'm trying to help people today and tell them how this foul demon out of hell has used the news media, has used the radios, has used the newspapers, and lies the God of this world to change and to blind the minds of people that believe not. How many of y'all know what 2 Corinthians 4:4 says? 2 Corinthians 4:4 says the God of this world blinds the minds of people. That's what his job is. That's what he does every day. The word "testify" in Ephesians 4:17, it talks about a witness. Y'all remember what that word meant? Martuomea? Am I got that word right? Martuomea. It's easy to look up. You got a Strong's. Just look up the word "testify." Paul said, at some point in time, I'll be called against you guys when you say you were serving God and you made the wrong time, because God will call me as a witness. I'm here to tell everybody and to plead with them, take your mind, because your mind is not saved. You know, your mind is something that's in your care. You've got to know it's vulnerable. It's up to the Christian to take their mind and to make themselves a powerful witness. Learn to get all the scriptures down inside of you. Learn to work on it. Don't believe that, oh yes, I'm saved because I believed in Jesus, I'm going to heaven. That's true. But a lot of people called are not chosen. He talked about the election of God. And you know what? That will tell you how many people is elected of God and called and chosen. Many people are called, but few are chosen. Why do you think they're called and not chosen? You look at this present world and they'll be preaching money to you. They'll talk about your jet airplane. They'll talk to you about reading and meditating in other books. It's good to meditate, but let me tell you something. The Bible said in 1 Timothy chapter 4, 13, 14, and 15, that you are to meditate in the Word. That's what Paul told Timothy. Read the Word and attend to reading. He says, and if you meditate in these things, you'll not only save yourself but others. Paul spent 3 years getting this revelation that he got from God. Philippians chapter 3, he says, man, I got the power of resurrection. I know what it's all about. In verse number 9 of Philippians 3, he said, you know what? He said, I thank God now through this revelation. He said, I've got the laws of faith working for me, and I'll not be found in my own righteousness, but I'll be found in the righteousness which comes by the faith of the living God, by learning how to use my faith, to believe in the scriptures. And it was in his heart. Over those 3 years, he learned the stuff that he had to use to face the devil. It takes a while to work out your faith with fear and trembling. Work out your salvation. Remember, we're living in times now that has never been like this time. Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, he said, there's times coming that they'll never be like this day that's coming. Neither has there ever been before, neither will it ever be afterwards. Daniel 12, 1 tells the whole story. I think this is the time when we challenge one another. We challenge one another with our faith. We challenge one another with what we believe. We challenge one another with scriptures. We attend prayer meetings. We learn the Word of God. He says, come out from the world, you know, and be ye separated people, saith the Lord. And I will receive you, and I'll be a God unto you. And I'll wipe away every tear from your eye one day. You shall be my sons and daughters, and I will bless you coming in, bless you going out. I bless everything you touch. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but 2 Corinthians 10:3 says they're mighty. And that's pulling down the devil's strongholds out of our mind. You learn how important the mind is. You learn how important and how vulnerable it is. Why are they after our children in schools to make homosexuals out of them? Why? Because they're after their mind. They want to put that LGBT on the door. Why have they got it on all the newscasts now? Why have all the programs on television turned to homosexuals, lesbians? And you ain't allowed to say the word homosexual today in the midst of a lot of people. They look at you like, oh, oh. You hear what he said? I'm sorry. They need to go back and see who Baal is. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Do y'all know who Baal is? I've preached it for the past 25 or 30 years. Probably longer than that. I preached it probably 40 years ago. And longer than that. But people don't know what Baal is. Baal and Ashtaroth. Get in Strong's Bible's concordance and look it all up in the scriptures. Go back to the book of Judges. That's a good place to find it. Baal and Ashtaroth were the gods they brought with them out of Egypt. These are the gods where they worship the male part of a man. They worship the male parts of a man. Can I say that loud and clear? That's their God. They actually worship that. They've been doing that all along. Oh, Israel wouldn't do that. No, they wouldn't do that. That's why God said, you break this covenant. He said, I will scatter you over the face of the earth. And he did. And they're the whore, and they never repented. And how many of y'all know our Bible does not need any help? Our Bible does not need an update. You know, we got to stand up. I don't care. Let them get mad about us. I don't care what they do. I'm not going to stop preaching our Bible. We need to warn our children. How many of y'all know to see what they did with people is remarkable? And how did they do it? They did it with the television and news media. with all the sports that they control now to pull people in, to brainwash them, to get Beyonce to worship her demons in front of all of our children that they'll want their personal demon too, and show you $40,000 football tickets and $25,000 baseball tickets and make it to be some famous thing where everybody says, oh yes, I need one. Come on, church, don't get quiet on me. How many of y'all know the world is the world? Amen? Amen. Come out of the world includes what? Come on, church, you know I'm preaching to you. Anyway, if you go back to 1 Peter, if you will with me. There's a little problem with people today that are not liking our message. If you love Jesus, say amen. Okay, in 1 Peter chapter 1, it says in verse 4 that we have an inheritance that's incorruptible and undefiled, it fadeth not away, and it's reserved into heaven for us, and everybody wants the great rewards. How many of y'all look forward to your kingdom? Amen? How many of y'all look forward to your new body? Boy, I'm sure tired of this one. I'm sure tired of this devil. Uh-oh. What happened? I'm sure tired of the devil and this body. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Now, you might like your body, but I don't like mine. No man ever yet hated his own self. When I get to heaven, I won't eat a piece of cherry pie. I'll be okay. Amen? I want to put some salt on my beans. I won't have to eat food without salt anymore. I mean, I could say that Jesus will make it okay and I won't even need salt. Amen? I mean, come on, church. We're having a problem today with even our food. Some Christians, they just believe they learn from Fox and CNN. They don't even know what GMO is or fluoride or vaccines or false education. They don't know about any of those things. They just believe, oh, I believe everything. Well, what is everything? I just believe everything. They remind me of Jimmy Swaggart who says, you can't be a Christian if you don't support Israel. Well, I want to write him a letter and say, do you mind telling us what we have to do to be a Christian so I know how to make my check out too? Do I make it to the homosexuals? Do I make it out to the Talmud people who sodomize everybody? Or do I make it out to the warmongers who want war? Or do I make it out to the 1.5% of the so-called Judaics, which they aren't real, that say they worship God and they believe in Moses' law? Tell me which group to make it out to, Mr. Swaggart, and define what you say. Come on, church. How many of y'all believe that every preacher today should be able to tell you a statement of what they believe? Before I give to any ministry, I like to see it in paper and say, what do you believe, buddy? Show me what you believe. People are tired of getting burnt. You know why I'm talking about paying your money as a tithe to give it to God and find out you're servicing a devil like Benny Hinn. People are tired of getting burnt. I got a form down there that we spent time on. I spent a whole day printing it out a couple of days so that we could tell people what we believe. Years ago when I first got in church, you go in there and they have it on the walls. It's called minutes. You need to tell people what you believe. You need to tell them everything about what you believe. If you believe in supporting the Antichrist temple in Israel, then tell them, I support the temple they're building, which has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. One lady told me down in Centerville, oh, my daughter's been supporting that temple institute for many years. I said, I wonder, does she know that she's given to a temple that has nothing to do with the God that she claims to know? Okay, don't y'all get quiet on me. I believe everybody should be, every church should have a statement of facts, a statement of faith in what they believe. Don't come up and tell me after I give you my tithe that you're believing in supporting a temple that has nothing to do with God. I mean, excuse me? How many of y'all know if you sow to the Spirit, you reap to the Spirit? The problem is a lot of people sow to the wrong spirit and they don't want to reap from that spirit. Wake up. Amen? So look what this says. We have a lot of good things that's waiting on us. It says in verse 9, it's eternal. Or verse 4, I mean. Say that's eternal and it fadeth not away. None corruptible, a brand new heaven. Look what it says in verse 5. And we are kept by the power of God through faith and the salvation, ready to be delivered in the last time. I want you to know something. Don't be afraid of what you believe, as long as it's scriptural. You know what? The Bible said in this word, foreknowledge, it will deliver you in due time. This word, you're kept. Me and Brother Mark was talking about it. Said you're kept by the power of God. You look up the word kept and it talks about a garrison of soldiers. Jesus talked about it whenever he was in the garden, and he said, I could presently call on my Father and he would give me 12 legions of angels. But you know, he came for this purpose. He trusted God. He believed God. He put God the Father to test. And I want you to know something now, that God is able to keep us in the time of trouble. He's able to rebuke the devourer. He's able to heal our body. He's able to fight the enemy, because he's a God that cannot fail. Can I hear an amen? We're struggling now with demons that want to turn our Bible around. But some people will say, I will live for God, and if it takes it, I will die for God too. Can I hear an amen? Amen. We will take up our cross daily and follow God. Amen. And I want you to know something. I believe verse 5, kept by the power of God through faith, ready to be revealed. We're not getting ready. There's some people out here that are ready. If you're ready, let me hear you say amen. There's some people out here are not preparing. We are ready. We live by faith. We're sanctified by the Spirit of God and by the Word of God. And because of that, we're called saints. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Some people don't know who the saints are. They're those that are sanctified. That's where the Word comes from. Amen? If you're a saint, let me hear you say amen. Amen. If you love Jesus, say amen. Okay, notice what they don't like, some of them. Charles Capps, he says, oh, yes. I get up in the morning and I speak my day. I can say it and I can make everything happen because my faith is so great. Oh yeah, him and Kenneth Copeland believed that, and Jesus had to go to hell and burn. You know, all of that kind of stuff. Those are blasphemous lies. Can I hear an amen? Just not in the Bible. Look what the Bible really teaches in verse 6. Wherein you greatly rejoice through now for a season. Notice he said the word season. If you got a way to underline that, you need to underline this, because every dog has his days. Amen? So I think we can have ours. He said, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptation. Why do we need be? Why do we need be? The Bible said in verse 7 that the trial of your faith be much more precious than gold that perisheth. I want you to know something. God wants to try you to get your trust out of money, to get your trust out of people, to get your trust out of the world, and to know that your faith will deliver you from the fiery furnace. It'll close the mouth of a lion. It'll cause you to slay Goliath. It'll cause you to tread upon serpents and scorpions. Somebody say amen. Amen. No weapon formed against us can prosper. Hallelujah. We can stand up for our Jesus and believe the Scriptures. God doesn't want us trusting in filthy lucre. Why did apostles call it filthy lucre? Why did Jesus say in Matthew 13, the deceitfulness of riches? Man cannot be delivered by money. Man cannot be delivered from the harm of flesh. But what we have that's called faith will deliver us in the time of trouble. It'll bring you through the fire. It'll shut up the mouth of a lion. Like David, you can reach down and get 5 smooth stones, and there ain't no devil can stand before you. We can begin to believe one another. If any two of you shall agree, as touching anything, it shall be done. We must go through the fire. We must be tried. Because you take the word believe, and you know what it means? To put to the test. God wants to test us to see how many people believe Him. To see how many people will stand in their faith. To see how many people will stand and serve God. God wants every one of us to be tried, because you know what? My gold is not going to deliver you. I believe in having a little bit of money to pay our bills, amen? But I'm going to tell you something. These devils today, you can trace them in the Bible and find out who they are. They're not very hard. You can look and see how they took 30 pieces of silver and gave to who? Judas Iscariot, so they could, you know, have him to give up Jesus. You can look and see in Matthew 27 how they gave money to the soldiers so that they would say that the disciples came while they were asleep and that they stole the body away. You can go and you can look, and the Bible says in Daniel chapter 38 that, you know, they worship the gods of gold and silver. You can look in Hebrews chapter 9 and see that they also never repented of any of their stuff. How many of y'all know they'd never repent in the whole Bible? They're the whore of Babylon. They started out being the whore of Babylon. They wound up being the whore of Babylon. They worship the sex gods. They worship the lying demons out of hell. And they are not going to stop. Can I hear an amen? Amen. You know how I know they're not? Because the Bible says it. Revelation 17:4, you can look at the whore of Babylon. It's not hard to look at it. All you got to do is get unbrainwashed. I mean, that's all it is. People that's brainwashed believe, oh yes, I want to give to God's people. I had a guy to call me from Pennsylvania. He said, Brother Inman, isn't that God's people I heard you preach about on the radio? I said, well, not according to DNA test. According to DNA test, they're from Russia and they have no DNA in their blood. But I want to tell you something else. Nobody else does either, because Jesus was the end of the bloodline. Can I hear an amen? Amen. The Bible teaches that Jesus is the bloodline. You want to get in Jesus and Abraham's blessings, you can find out who the people of God really are. Got demons want you to believe in flesh and blood. Amen? Amen. So we look at people that are trusting in money today. How that those guys, and if you get a chance, I could show you. How that those guys in verse 7, how that they trusting in money today, they're preaching it by the way of television, preaching it by the way of radio. John Hagee wants you to lift up and give your money to Israel, who has nothing to do with God today. He himself is a rabbi. Can I hear an amen? Revisionist history. You go back to their website, they'll bring it out to you in their Judaism Discovered book. He's a rabbi. He wants to bomb Iran. Iran has never bombed anybody else. They have no terrorists from their country. They haven't bothered anybody. The only people who wants to destroy Iran is people that listen to John Hagee and Fox News. I wonder why that. Why those guys get up and talk about a vicious Russia now we have to deal with. Russia hadn't bothered nobody. They went into Ukraine to stop them devils from destroying everybody. And they stopped ISIS, and that's what they're mad about. We need to stand up as Christians and begin to get some prayer groups. Begin to pray. And stop letting these lies of television and news media, news outlets, and these kind of people flush the brains, brainwash people. Just flush any good stuff out of your brain and cause you to believe those lying devils. I told you when I started this message about the Bible and what it had to say about the mind. What you hear in your mind and what you meditate on is what gets in your heart, and that's what you become. You wonder why these guys with all of their stuff, they want to get up and tell you about, we need a preemptive strike against Iran. Why would you want to bomb millions of people in a country that isn't bothering anybody based upon Israel's fear that somebody's going to bomb them? They know ain't nobody going to fool with them, because they know if they did, the United States would bomb them with about 1,000 jet airplanes with what they call carpet bombing, if you know what that is. They put so many bombs on them that they have a bomb every 50 yards or something, you know, of their whole nation. With 1,000 different air bases in the world, military bases, we can do it. But that's why you read Revelation 13, verse 4, and you find out why it says, who can make war with the beast? If they don't get them with the bullets, they get them with a harp. Can I hear an amen? Amen. How many of y'all know about harp? Amen. I won't go into harp, because the people in the television, they don't really know what that is. But anyway, we know about harp. Can you hear? Can I hear you say amen? Amen. If people need to learn about it, go to the YouTube.com and type it in. What is harp? Expose harp. You find out how they invaded Thailand, how they invaded the Philippines, how they've invaded Pakistan, how they've taken down Liberia, how they've taken down Libya, how they've taken down Iraq. I mean, Afghanistan was just a drug deal. They wanted to control all the dope. How many of y'all like the dope they brought to us? Ain't they brought some real powerful dope in this country? Well, y'all got real quiet on me then. Okay. Are you finished? I want you to go with me back to the book of 1 Peter once more. I want you to go to verse 14 and 15, 16 and 17. I'm sorry for getting off base a little bit. Notice what it says in verse 14. If you notice something about taking care of your mind, he uses that in the verse right before he talks about fashioning yourself, to fashion yourself against your elders and the bloodline that you come from. How many of y'all are glad to be delivered from Adam? I'm talking about the first Adam. He talks about this in verse 13 about protecting your mind. Gird up the loins of it. That means the strength. Protect your mind. Learn to nourish your mind by the Word of God. Learn to protect it and don't allow your mind to be attacked by the devil. And look what he says in verse 14. As obedient children, not fashion yourself after the former lust and your ignorance. In other words, if you don't take care of your mind, you'll be fashioned like the world. Are you here? This is what it talks about, the foreknowledge of God laying down for a pattern to you, telling you what happens to people that turn their mind over to lust and the world. It will form you and shape you after the lust nature. Can I hear an amen? That's what it's all about. You learn how to keep yourself because the time is very wicked, very short, and very powerful. I'm talking about the things that we're facing with the human mind. These demons are very powerful. Look what it says in verse 15. It says, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it's written, be ye holy, for I'm holy. If you want to keep yourself from the wicked one, if you want to live pleasing to God, you can know what it means over here in verse 4 to have your inheritance which is kept for you. Many people today are called and they'll never see their inheritance. Because why? Oh, they don't mind. They listen to worldly music. They watch worldly television. They believe in, you know, the Illuminati's LGBT. And they believe in the Hollywood demons that are trying to feed everybody with pornography and lies and deception. Some people's tired of that junk. Can I hear an amen? If you want to be holy, practice it. Try to keep your mind. That's the last thing, according to Ephesians 4:23, that you do before you put on the new man. Amen? We have to protect our mind. Don't let the devil, with verse 14, fashion you after lust. And that's what it will do. If you notice, this is very interesting. After you call on the Father, whom without respect of persons judges according to every man's work, why, you're a pilgrim here. Your time is sojourning here in fear. And it's not talking about the spirit of fear like Adam. It's talking about fearing this world. You know, if you don't fear the world, you're not very smart. You have to watch yourself, amen? Amen? Because the devil will take the world and he'll draw the life of God right out of you. I've seen a story on this guy where he was a little innocent guy from Iowa. And he's got a pretty cool website. He was telling about how that Halloween was against the law years ago. About 150 years ago, they brought it into this country, the Catholic Church did, which was controlled by the Jews. They brought it into this country and how he was celebrating Halloween, and from there went all the way out to the time to where he became a vampire, drinking a lot of blood, worshiping the devil. He said they told him that Jesus had come on the cross to deliver us from God the Father, Jehovah. He said, that's what I believed. He became a 33rd degree Mason. You know, he did not know. But you know, he finally got saved. He said he drank all this blood and everything. He had all these powers with him and he thought he was really doing great stuff. And he said he gave to the witches thing every year with his checks. And I think it was San Francisco where he wrote his check to. And He said there's a little lady that was a teller there. When she saw who his check was made out to, that she signed on a check and said, "I'll be praying for you to my Jesus." He said, "I just thought that was a piece of trash." You know, that back in those days, they sent the checks to you. You know? So, he turns around, and after a few days, he said, "The strangest thing happened. I was doing so good. I had all this power, and I could do a lot of stuff." He said, "In a few days, I lost all my power." He said, "I didn't know what was going on." He said, "I couldn't work no more magic." He says, "And the power was real. It just left me." He said, "That's really strange." He said, "I didn't know what it was then." He said, "The next couple of days," he said, "I prayed to Satan and I asked him to tell me, what did I do wrong?" He said, "There's a couple of little ladies come from Chicago up to Milwaukee where I was staying and said, those little two teenagers said, we want to be witches." He said, "I said, okay, come on in." At that time, he had been raised up in the occult world. And he said, they handed him some tracts and said, "Look at this foolish stuff that Jack Chick wrote about witches." Because Jack Chick was exposing them. He said he threw them in a drawer. He didn't think nothing about it. But his story goes on to tell that finally he gave his life to Jesus. After going through a whole lot of stuff, joining a Mormon church, becoming a 33rd degree Mason. But my point is, the prayers of one little woman changed his whole life. God put it in her heart to pray for him. Aren't you glad that the power of prayer is so much greater than the power of Satan? Amen. It's so good to know that our prayer is so powerful and God can do anything through the prayers. The effectual, fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. You know, it's so sad that you've got these things that's going on in this country for people that don't really have a walk with God. How many of y'all know who David Jeremiah is? I asked Homer last week, he liked his preaching, and we all did. You look on his platform at his church, which used to be Tim LaHaye's church, and he's got Horus, H-O-R-U-S. How many of y'all, anybody know who Horus is? That's the Egyptian god. They got it right on his platform. You can see it. You can pull it up on the web, look at it, go to his platform and look at him on Shadow Mountain Church, and he's right there. But then if you get to reading the feedback on Shadow Mountain Church, he's always quoting witches and things like that, of what they said, using that in his preaching. So you know, that's pretty sad that we live in this kind of times. It's so deceiving that even the very elect would be saved if it wasn't for Jesus shorting these days. The spirit of the devil is out today to destroy people. I want you to go with me to 1 Peter chapter 5, and then I'm going to come back. Well, stay right, I'm sorry, 1 Peter 1:18. Let's stay here for a minute. If I get time, I'll go to 5. For as much as you know that we were redeemed, not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by the traditions of your father, but with the precious blood of the Lamb, without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised up Jesus from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might rest in God. So we know we've been redeemed. If you know it, say amen. We wasn't redeemed with silver and gold. God never would bow down to silver and gold to let them be anything that has to do with the people of God. Now, 1 Peter chapter 5. Turn a couple pages over with me. 1 Peter chapter 5. He said, "The elders among you I exhort, who am also an elder and a witness of the suffering of Christ, and a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed in him. Feed the flock of God, which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, neither for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind." Here we talk about a mind again. Get it in your heart today and in your mind to do the will of the Lord. Look at all of the rewards that God wants to give people for feeding the flock of God. We're now covering most of Europe and China, all the way to Russia and many places every night at 8 o'clock. Every Saturday and Sunday morning at 8 o'clock. We're now on 9265 shortwave radio out of Red Lion, Pennsylvania. Every Sunday night at 9:30 till 10 o'clock. We now come on every night, Tuesday night through Saturday night, right here on WBRI, out of Okeechobee, Florida. It's 100,000 watt shortwave radio, goes all over the world. You know, we're doing our part to try to reach as many people as possible. A lot of these countries we're going in, they don't even have preachers. They don't even know what we're talking about. But you know, this is the door, kind of like what Paul had preached when he went into some of these countries. But I ask you guys to pray with us about this, that we can get to these people to help them. We're able to have our time to preach to them. I like the little Bible we sent to Michael Okori over in Africa. I believe it's a time that we can lay up treasures in heaven, and we can do what Matthew chapter 6 says, lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where there's neither moth nor corrosion nor corruption. I believe what we do now is so important. There's not one scripture in the Bible that they can use for what they're preaching today. I believe people that trust in money are going to be so let down when they find out that they have put their faith in the wrong thing. Your faith has got to be greater than money. The Bible said in 1 Peter chapter 5, said, feed the flock of God in verse 2, which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not willingly, but by reason of him, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but be an example to the flock, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. Likewise, younger, submit yourself to the elders. God giveth grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he might exalt you in due time. And I believe for people today that want to humble themselves, I believe they have a great reward in heaven. Amen? I want to close my message now because I'm running out of time with Colossians chapter 1, starting with verse 15. Remember, they're trying to turn us over as a church group. They're trying to turn us over to the temple of Israel, to a brand new Ark of the Covenant, to a brand new menorah where they got the candles burning and all that stuff. They want to come around and bring everybody in to believe that Jesus is not really God. But the Bible said in Colossians 1:15, look what it says. Jesus, who forgave us of our sins in verse 14, is the image of the invisible God, and he is the firstborn of every creature. You can't see him today, but let me tell you, he is the image of God. He's the firstborn of every creature. Meaning there was nothing else before him. Look what it said in verse 16. By him were all things created. Do you see that? That are in heaven, things that are in the earth, things that are invisible, whether they be thrones, whether they be dominions, principalities or powers, all things were created by Christ Jesus. And he is before all things. In other words, he was before anything. There's nothing that ever existed before him. He created the heavens and the earth. In the Hebrew, it calls it cosmos. That means all the planets and everything. Jesus created them. I don't care what they say. I know Jesus is our God. Can I hear an amen? And he is the head of the body of the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn, the first one resurrected from the dead. And that in all things he might have the first place. For it pleased the Father that in him should all the fullness dwell. You know, we need to bring our people to have words for people. I'm talking about whether they be Muslims, whether they be Jews, whoever they are, we need to know our Bible. We need to have something quote to them, because Jesus said, devil, it is written. We need to tell people something that will help them to know the real truth, that Jesus is the great God Almighty. He is the only God, and He's a God that lives forever, and He's a God that casts people into hell as well as give them eternal life. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap.